Thank you very much for the intro. So I'll now start sharing my screen. Okay, you should hopefully be able to now see the screen. So hi, thank you all for coming today. I'm Pierre and I'm a data scientist at the SAS Institute of London. And apart from that, I'm also a writer on towards data science and I do some freelancing projects at times. And before that, I did an MSc in Artificial Intelligence at the University of Southampton in the UK. So some of my work, for example, has been featured by, shared by articles, have been shared by Kaggle, by NVIDIA AI, and one of my articles I suggested reading for Cornell University for game theory. And I also had the opportunity to contribute to a couple of open source repositories such as Streamlit or Rapids AI. So in order to get started with the talk today, let's start by defining, first of all, what are paradoxes? So paradoxes are a class of phenomena which arise when, although starting from premises known as true, we derive some form of logically unreasonable result. As machine learning models create knowledge from data, this makes them therefore susceptible to possible cognitive paradoxes between training and testing. So today I'm going to introduce you to a few different paradoxes we can encounter when going through a data science project. And the first one we're going to introduce is, how can you do even data science without data? And I'm going to introduce you to modeling and simulations. Then the Simpson paradox, the accuracy paradox, the ability qualitative paradox, and the law of unintended consequences. So in order to get started, modeling simulations is a set of techniques which you can use in order to perform data science analysis without any actual data. So this can be more common than expected. So for example, if you remember at the beginning of the pandemic in early 2020, there were different people and organizational bodies trying to create models to predict, for example, the spread of COVID, or trying to model how COVID will spread around, what could have been the consequences of doing different types of restrictions, such as closing down bars, closing schools, and so on. And they were all trying to do these estimates without any data. So if you were a data scientist and you were trying to create a model to predict the number of cases, you weren't able to do that at the beginning because you didn't have any past data. And one way to try to do it, to solve this problem, is to create a sort of synthetic environments in which you simulate your own world and then run a simulations there in order to then generate data, which you can use for your simulations. And first of all, it's really important here to mention that whenever we try to create a model, which is can be a machine learning model, so a model of an environment, it's important to remember that essentially all models are wrong at the end of the day, but some of them can be useful. So none of this model can really always get 100% accuracy or perfectly represent the real world scenario. But especially during time, models can degrade in performance and therefore their efficiency changes. It's not constant and perfect. So there are two main modeling approaches which you can take when trying to create these sort of mathematical simulations, which then you can generate data from. And one approach is mathematical models. And in this kind of approach are typically used in order for, such as for, in order to, for example, create compartmental models in epidemiology. And in this case, you just make use of a set of differential equations in which you can then run against time to generate data. Then there are process models, which are based more like commonly known as agent-based modeling. And these are commonly used, for example, in order to do portfolio optimization or for military training simulations and these kind of things. So as I mentioned before, compartmental models can be expressed as a set of differential equations. And you can see here that each of these equations has different parameters. And these parameters can then correspond to, as the name says, to a different compartment into a graph. And you can see here, in this case, we're talking about a simple SIR model, which is three different compartments. And when we do this kind of analysis, we start from a model which we assume there is a population of individuals. All the individuals are susceptible to a disease. And then from these individuals can move from the susceptible state to the infected state and to finally the recovered state. And if these individuals move from one state to another in the simulation, it depends on a certain rate, probability, and the number of individuals that are currently in a state. And if you run this simulation using the ordinary differential equations, you will then be able to get this kind of curves of, for example, an epidemic or pandemic going on. And these curves quite closely resemble the one, for example, you might have seen from governments and research study during the beginning of the pandemic. And you can see that from this curve, for example, you can derive then the R value, which is R0 and so on. So in that you can see how the R value varies over time and then determine the R0 of the overall the disease spreading in a population. But if you don't want to use the old school mathematical equations, you can also decide to go for a different approach, which is agent-based modeling. And in this case, basically you create an object-oriented class. And from this class, you can instantiate different abilities and characteristics of an individual. And this can be as complicated as you wish. So therefore, obviously, the more they resemble the real environment, the more they can be able to actually predict well in how the different individuals in the populations can interact with each other and then spread the disease. And this can then, once you created a class, you can then just create a simple algorithm here, like I show you here, one, for example, I made, in which you just run through the different days in the population for each individual, and you start throwing probabilities of if someone could get infected or not, depending on sets of rules which you can define. And running again the simulations, you get back very similar results to the one you got with the mathematical model I was showing you before. And in this case, for example, you can see also here the different spots individuals represent these two grids, these two 2D grid moving around during the simulation. And if you're interested in doing this in Python or get started with creating modeling simulations, here there is a quick example of what you can, for example, do using open source packages such as Mesa or Ash. And this one, for example, was created with Mesa, and that's an open source Python package you can use in order to create this kind of graphs really easily. Instead, in my case, they were custom made since there was nothing specific to COVID in early 2020. And this one instead is an example of using Ash, which is another open source platform basically you can use. This one is not a package, but there is an online website where you can actually run the simulations and find templates from where you can start from. And if you are not good with Python or you don't like coding in general, there are also some form of enterprise software which have free tiers which you can use, such as AnyLogic or Blender, which you can use then to get started using a graphical user interface. And this modeling simulation can be also important for synthetic data generation in general, for creating machine learning models and so on. So moving on to the second paradox. This is called the Simpson paradox. And the Simpson paradox is a phenomenon in probability statistics in which a trend appears in several different subgroups of data, but it either appears or reverses when these groups are combined together. And this paradox can be resolved just by when taking into consideration the causal relationship between different variables and then uncover a hidden variable behind it. So as an example, let us consider a thought experiment. We carried out a research study in order to find out if doing physical exercise can help you or not reduce cholesterol levels. And we are now starting to examine the obtained results. First, we divide our population into two main categories based on individual age, under or over 60 years old. And then we plot the cholesterol levels against the number of hours the subject exercised per day. By examining the results in the first two plots, we can then infer that exercising for more hours a day, they can lead to an overall reduction in the cholesterol levels. And this hypothesis can also be reinforced by examining the overall trend of the best fit line inferred through the linear regression and the quite strong negative positive Pearson correlation score in both cases. At this point, we can be reassured by the first two graphs. And we can try to repeat the same analysis by taking simulation, this time the whole population sample, as shown in the rightmost plot. And in this case, we are faced with a completely contradictory scenario, and a positive correlation implying that more exercise can lead to an increase in cholesterol levels. This type of scenario is commonly known as the Simpson paradox, and takes place every time we have some form of correlation which points in a direction when we consider different subgroups, like on the plots on the left. And the correlation points are set in a completely opposite direction when we consider the whole group, like shown on the right. And in order to unveil the reason behind this type of mechanism, we need to try to go beyond the provided data and think about how our data was generated in the first place to cause this outcome. For example, thinking about what unknown missing variable we might preventing us to see the full picture. So moving on to another experiment, continuing experiment, we can consider that, for example, our missing variable could be, for example, like an individual comorbidities or diet or age, any type of variable which can be related to the experiment. And we decide to take a closer look at how cholesterol levels vary with greater age in this example. And repeating the same analysis we've done in the figures before on the previous slide, we can then clearly see how cholesterol levels are strongly positively correlated in individual age. And from the results, we can then deduce that cholesterol levels are more likely to increase with aging and lack of exercise. There is a cause-effect relationship between the three variables. And therefore, in order to quantify the benefit of exercising in reducing cholesterol levels and overcome the Simpson paradox, we should then be able to make sure that to run our experiment while having a fixed value for age and of the subject. Therefore, this being our controlling variables. And during the course of the last century, the Simpson paradox occurred in many statistical studies, such as the Usher-Berkley gender bias, the Kinistow treatment, and also the racial disparity in death penalty analysis made in the US. And if you're interested in learning more about causality and the Simpson paradox in general, there is a book written by Julia Pearl, which is called The Book of Why, which I strongly recommend you to look at. So moving on, we can now see the next paradox, which is called the accuracy paradox. So in our daily life, it is quite common to think that going deeper into studying a subject or learning a topic really well will necessarily lead to a greater understanding of the study phenomena. Although this isn't always true, as over-specialization can at times lead us to underestimate the importance of the bigger picture. And this same pattern can also happen when creating machine learning models that are more complex than necessary. In this case, our model will end up focusing too much on a single data point and not paying attention to the overall trend of the data, so overfitting basically. And in this scenario, our model will be able to perform well on the training data, of which it memorizes every single detail, while failing to generalize on its data. This problem can be summarized as shown in the figure on the slide. So in this figure, we is taking into consideration an example of a regression problem, how house prices vary with the number or with increase of the number of rooms in a property in Italy. And creating a complex model which overfits, we would be able to, in this case, to get a really good estimate of the house price in Italy, although our complex model will most likely perform worse than a linear model underfitting, which when trying, for example, to predict the house prices of another country, such as on which the model has been trained, such as, for example, Spain. And this leaves us, therefore, with an accuracy paradox. We train machine learning models to improve their accuracy over time, while this might also lead to a lower accuracy into the actual production environment. And a quote which really summarizes this problem is here made by Charles Goodhart says, when a measure becomes a target, then it ceases to be a good measure. So therefore, obviously, if you try to push too much for getting perfect results with a specific target while forgetting what was the aim of the prediction itself, that can just lead to worse performances overall. And one of the most common approaches to overcome these kind of issues in ML is obviously regularization, so adding a model complexity penalty. And in this way, you can reduce the weights associated to the less important features and focus our attention on features which provide us with more information. In class deviation problems, instead, like we didn't consider now, the accuracy paradox is most likely to appear when working with unbalanced training data sets, in which some classes appear with much more frequency than others. And in this instance, calculating the precisions and recall of the model can be some good variable metrics in order to try to understand if there is overfitting or not. So, and the concept of overfitting can also be related, closely related to how the Pareto principle works. So, which says that for many outcomes, roughly 80% of the consequences comes from 20% of the causes. So, if you have a problem that you're trying to solve, usually if you focus just on the main parts, you solve 80% of the problem while trying to desperately trying to get the other 20% of the problem done. You risk to overfit on your problem and actually get worse performances or an exponential time in order to try to actually get the best results possible. And then there is our fourth paradox for today. There is a learnability Gödel paradox. So Kurt Gödel is one of the most famous mathematicians of the last century. And one of his most famous theories at the time was the two Gödel's incompleteness theorems. And according to these theorems, nowadays mathematics has some intrinsic limitations, which makes it impossible for us to tell if something is really true or not. And the whole field of data science is deeply interconnected with mathematical thinking, and therefore this leads us to a paradox. And for example, when machine learning models relies heavily on using sample data sets for training themselves. And if the Gödel paradox actually proves to be true, that basically means that we cannot perform any form of extrapolation or prediction on a finite sample to predict an infinite sample, therefore making our machine learning models pointless in the first place and not be able to generalize at all when actually working in the long term. And finally, as the last paradox I was planning to cover today, there is the law of unintended consequences. So, as systems and models become more and more complicated, it can turn out for us humans to be more difficult to understand how the system might work behind the scenes. And this concept is summarized by the law of unintended consequences. According to this concept, as systems grow in complexity, it is more likely that undesired behaviors or bugs might involuntarily occur. This frequency turns out to be true when creating big software projects or creating sophisticated machine learning models. And with the advent of the big data regime in recent years, there has been a growing interest in creating techniques which can make our models more explainable and bias-free, so that to combine with governmental bodies or regulations such as, for example, the GDPR. Ultimately, this leaves us with the last paradox considered for today. Day by day, we try to create the best possible model to achieve a result. Although this might never be the point of production because it's too complex to be understandable and therefore to be able to comply with, for example, Article 5 of the right of explanation of the GDPR. And this could potentially end up with something like the Murphy's Law, where if you have a really complex system and you don't understand it, you just go against it and say, think like anything that can go wrong will always go wrong, like Murphy's Law states. And okay, so let's leave us with the quick conclusion here, where as part of the presentation, I introduce you to some of the main paradoxes associated with data science, although many other common paradoxes could potentially have implications in data science, artificial intelligence. Some other examples which we didn't consider for today are the friendship paradox in network analysis, in which you can find out why your friends have always more friends than you. and the Parkinson paradox, the Bryce paradox, Moravec paradox, the Gordy paradox, and the list goes on. And if you have any paradox you would like to add to this list, please feel free to leave a comment in the chat. So now I wanted to finally also show you really quickly the dashboard I introduced you to when I talk about the epidemic modeling, in case you're interested to give it a play, since it's freely available online at the moment. I can also leave a link in the chat later so that you can understand how the system works. So as you can see here, this is basically the dashboard I created when creating different epidemiology models and comportamental and agent-based models. And in this case, you can start, for example, by exploring the overview of the number of cases of COVID. You can see the whole world map. You can regulate to mean, get a precise number of cases for each country. You can see here how the number of cases and deaths changes over a precise period of time, or you can also see a time lapse, for example, of the deaths of and how this varied by each individual country. And moving on, the different models I introduced before. So for example, if you're interested in creating agent-based models, like I said before, with using basically a class of agents and simulating an environment, you can start by here, for example, by setting up a set of equations, providing different parameters for the population size, the probability of death, the contact ratios, or how the different individuals are to be close to each other in order to actually spread the disease, and so on. And then you can create the same graphs I show you in the presentation. And if you want, you can also see them running in real time and see how the people were moving in the environment and therefore getting a feeling of how they actually the pandemic evolves over time. And if you want, you can also here create more sophisticated sort of animations. So in this case, we select a single community, so which could be a small town, for example. But if you want, you can select four communities with a shared central point. And in this case, you can see that if you press play, we get these four different towns and some people which commute to different towns. And you can see, for example, that how the pandemic started in a single community and spreads to the other communities over time. And then from starting from this simple simulation, you can create even more complicated ones, such as, for example, ones including track and tracing. And this one can also be quite interesting to see, especially considering that track and trace is theoretically the best possible solution you can take. But that's true only if you get all the people who actually tested positive to immediately go to this sort of quarantine area. Otherwise, if even just a small percentage of people don't go to this right quarantine area in this case, the disease still spreads. So for example, you can see here at the putting a really fast number for how people are compliant with the policy, you can see that basically the curve of epidemiology now is completely flat. But if, for example, you change the parameters here for the population, if it's static or if there are more communities altogether, then you will see that the number of the simulation will start increasing quite a bit. And then there are also here other examples which are, for interest of time, I can go through for, like, so for example, like the effect of having a central app, which can be, for example, doing a lockdown in which people don't move from their house, but at the same time, they all go to a common central hub, which can be like, for example, a shopping center or where, a place where you can go buy food. And therefore, how can this affect the population? And then, for example, finance simulations of how people's incomes can change if they have to be working from home and so on, especially considering that some people might get furlough and can have implications on my financial support. Then here, moving on, there are the SIR and SAIR models, which I showed you before on the slides, which are the mathematical models which you can use. And also here, from there, you can see that you can create this sort of nicely done equations, and then you can go on and create more complicated models, such as, for example, models taking into account time-limited immunity from a disease, or have been vaccinated, and how can this impact or reduce the epidemiologic curve. And finally, if you decided to play actually with this dashboard, you can also come here and give feedback and choose, okay, if I'm a decision maker from a government, Will I feel more confident to use the compartmental models or the agent-based models? And then you can leave your vote. And you can see here the statistical sample with the p-value to get some form of feedback of how this experiment is going in real time.